pleasure.
What was your initial reaction when you heard that it was possible to stop a child from growing?
I just thought, how sensible.
Why wouldn't you do that? Why wouldn't being smaller make life easier and better?
The taller she gets, the more her world gets smaller. The less she gets to do.
I was pretty horrified that people would go to such an extreme measure to make life more convenient for themselves.
Don't worry, said the bear with a laugh.
Come and live my life for a day. Come and see how Khan is for a day.
Like most kids, Georgia and Draven Fesenfeld are full of life. They're reaching all the normal milestones for children their age.
Here you go.
Ready? And turn around and stand up with your back against the door. Ready? Stand up nice and tall, and Daddy's just going to mark where the top of your head is on the door.
Today, Rob and Janine want to see how much the kids have grown in the past few months.
And George, 3 years.
No, not with your hands. Just wait. And there. Look. There's Draven.
But they won't be measuring their eldest child, 9-year-old Daryl-Ann. That's because she reached her final height just over 2 years ago, after they deliberately stopped her from growing any taller.
Wow, Georgie, you've almost caught up to Daryl.
Yeah.
Daryl's got cerebral palsy, which is effectively a brain injury, very similar to if a child is drowned. On top of that, she's got microcephaly because her brain hasn't grown, so that means she's got a small head.
Daryl-Ann's birth went horribly wrong. It was a full 6 minutes before she took her first breath. She's had seizures since the day she was born.
You've got blue eyes. You can see the colour of your eyes. You feel free to bring cheese
around. It's been 9 months anticipating a child's birth. And then somebody almost takes away the child you're expecting and gives you back something completely different. I remember clearly Rob and I had said, you know, we'd keep going camping and doing all that fun stuff. When we had a kid, we wouldn't let a kid make it make daily life tricky, you know. We'd be that kind of parent. There's no way you could take Daryl camping. No way.
With two other small children, they rarely leave the house without a carer to help with Daryl-Ann.
We work so hard to keep everything routine.
Yeah, Daryl.
Daryl needs attention for every single facet of her life. She can't do anything on her own. She's nearly 10 years old, but she can't even tell us yes or no. So she needs everything.
That responsibility and the practicalities that came with her condition were heartbreaking for Janine and Rob.
Rob, for a long time, really, really hated putting her in her wheelchair because you'd have to sit her in and then you'd have to do all the straps up and then you'd have to strap her feet in, and he just hated it because he felt like he was punishing her, putting her in this wheelchair. We really didn't want to have hoists and equipment and all of that thing coming between us.
So just over 4 years ago, they made the decision to medically stunt Daryl-Ann's growth. High doses of hormones speed up puberty, causing the growth plates at the end of long bones, like legs and arms, to close sooner.
It was just so sensible. Why wouldn't we do it? It just seemed so natural.
By rushing Daryl-Ann through an early puberty, she'd never grow to her full adult height. Prescribing estrogen for children dates back to the 1940s, when it was used to treat excessive growth disorder. Then from the 50s through to the 70s, very tall women were not considered good marriage material, so a new use emerged. Some countries, including Australia, gave estrogen to healthy adolescent girls if they were at risk of growing too tall. By 2006, yet another kind of patient was being treated.
It was a little girl in the state of Washington, destined to stay a little girl for the rest of her life.
Growth attenuation, as the treatment's called, suddenly made headlines.
Her name is Ashley, and she's 9 years old, but she has the mental and physical abilities of a 3-month-old. Her parents made a decision to essentially freeze her in time with a treatment called...
When her growth attenuation treatment became public, it sparked huge ethical debate.
Our society has a tendency to want to solve big social problems with easy, relatively speaking, technological fixes.
But the controversy surrounding Ashley's case didn't put off families like the Fesenfelds. They saw a rare glimmer of hope.
I was immersed in the world of disability, so it didn't seem unnatural at all, because everything we were doing was changing her.
Good bouncing, Georgia.
Keeping Daryl-Ann small means she can have fun with the rest of the family.
Look, her eyes are very, very wide, aren't they, Georgia? All the lights, all the noise, all the bouncing, hey? Good, eh?
Do you think she enjoys this?
She loves it, yeah.
How can you tell?
When she's alert like this, when she's looking around, she's into it. There's actually something going on that's big enough for her to notice. She loves the noise, she loves the atmosphere. A kid like Daryl needs huge sensory input to really get that excitement going. So you can see her head's up. She never puts her head up like this. And then she's really, really excited about something. She's watching all the kids around there jumping. And if she was bigger than this, there's no way she'd get to do this.
Stunting Daryl-Ann's growth made perfect sense to her parents. But they needed to find a doctor who'd agree to treat her.
I was shocked. I said, oh, look, it sounds pretty crazy to me. I don't want to be involved in that.
They approached Dr. Ben Wheeler, a paediatric endocrinologist.
Okay, so this is a bone age x-ray for Daryl-Ann, and this just shows the growth plates in the hand.
The family's request was counter to all of Dr. Wheeler's training and ethics.
Promoting growth, promoting health and well-being is what we do, and on first pass this seemed like something that the child themselves weren't consenting for, and that most people would consider a negative or detrimental treatment.
Ready? You got guitar, Caleb.
Well, it became more and more clear to me that this wasn't a black and white issue at all. It was trying to work our way through what was already, I guess, a personal tragedy for Daryl-Ann and her family.
Yeah, would you like one too? Maybe we can get that maraca for you and you can shake one too. Yeah, ta.
We would have gone in. We would have had Daryl on our lap.
Steady, go.
He could see how natural and how logical and it was. That doctor part of him wanted to say no. That's not right.
They spoke multiple times of the feeling that she was really their baby and sort of a permanent baby. And in all fairness, that's true. She's 3 or 4 months developmental age. Again, concepts I hadn't really completely thought of, that to hold her and hug her like a baby was something they've just felt intuitively was required as long as they could envisage that happening.
He agreed to do the treatment if it was also approved by ethicists.
So, thanks for coming. We're here to talk about paediatric bioethics again.
Like Dr. Wheeler, they were heavily influenced by Janine and Rob's account of why they wanted to keep Daryl-Ann small.
They realised that they could use hoists and other types of equipment, but they wanted to maintain the closeness with Daryl-Ann that they felt that they already had. It was very persuasive, and there was one sort of key phrase I can recall from the letter, that they would resist putting mechanics between them and their daughter to the very end.
Okay, so this is a growth chart for Daryl-Ann, and what we see here, these are some measurements.
With ethics approval and the support of the hospital, Daryl-Ann's hormone treatment began.
These are her growth measurements, and essentially when she's an adult, looking at her bone age currently, she's going to sit way down here, which is about 40 or more centimetres shorter than a comparable child of her age. In terms of, was it successful? Well, we did stop her growing, and her final height is approximately 120 centimetres now.
While there's just a few cases in New Zealand where disabled children have had their growth stunted, worldwide there are about 70 recorded cases, most in the United States.
I think it's quite disturbing that it seems to have been relatively easy for people to get access to such an extreme medical intervention measure. I'm Kelly Vincent, and I'm the Dignity for Disability representative in the upper house of South Australian Parliament.
Here in Australia, there have been no publicly reported cases of growth attenuation therapy, yet. And Kelly Vincent wants to make sure there never is, unless there's a medical need for it.
So we are very concerned about this, and so we've called on the South Australian government to ensure that children and adults with disability are legally protected from forced medical treatment.
Past experience has left disability advocates alarmed by any medical treatment that targets the disabled.
There were many women who were sterilised because of their disability, particularly during the 70s and 80s, who've since come out saying things like, I want to have a period, I would have been able to raise children with the right support and the right education. And I think the same could be true of growth attenuation. Who knows whether in a few years or a few decades' time, whether these same people will come out saying that they feel a sense of loss.
1, 2, 3, 4.
The people that we've met, though, who've received this treatment would not be capable in a few years' time of coming out and saying anything or communicating anything.
I think people end up being quite different to what is indicated by medical advice substantially and frequently. The medical advice my parents were given, for example, was don't love her too much, she's about to die. And here we are 28 years later.
Bear was strolling in the forest one day when he met a small boy sitting on a tree stump.
They're a tight-knit trio, Susie Paisley and her two boys, 12-year-old Khan and Gabe, who's 6. So much of their world is inside the family home.
Don't worry, said the bear with a laugh. I'll soon show you the way out.
Khan is really responsive to our voices, particularly Gabe's. I think he really likes the sort of energy that Gabe brings.
Gabe knows his big brother is fragile.
When he's really sick or really sad, he can go quite greyish.
And what's it like when you're seeing that happen?
Really scary.
When Khan was born, Susie was told that he wouldn't live more than a few weeks.
Khan has had a birth injury. His official diagnosis is spastic quadriplegic cerebral palsy. He can't swallow, he can't eat. He really can't do anything on his own at all. He can, he sucks on. I think that he is possibly the most disabled child who is still alive at his age in New Zealand.
Every day has been a battle for survival for 12 long years. And as he gets bigger, he weighs 32 kilograms now, Susie's also battling.
When I carry Khan down the hall in the morning, we've got a mirror at the end of the hallway. I always look and go, oh my God, he's the same size as me. He's already just about not manageable.
And if he was bigger?
He would be unmanageable. I wouldn't be able to sit on the couch and cuddle him. And that's a huge part of Khan's day, and it's also a huge contributor to Khan's quality of life and happiness. He loves a cuddle. I love a cuddle. You know, we cuddle so well together.
Susie's a single mum, and with Khan so dependent on her, Gabe's become more independent.
He sort of has to, because I've got Khan on my knee for quite a bit of the day.
Give me a shoe.
We have to get onto your shoelace tying skills, eh? Very good. Okay, breakfast. Gabe has to run around and get medication and, yeah, make his own breakfast and get dressed and... Oh, delicious. Yeah.
That looks fabulous.
What do you think, Kenny? Delicious.
Cafe-style breakfast.
It is. Okie dokie. Get it down, yeah.
It's not an easy life, but it is their best shot at being a family, if it can be preserved.
Okay, Carly, we're just going to change your patch, okay?
6 months ago, Susie started the controversial treatment that will stop Khan reaching his full adult height. One doctor predicted that without it, he could grow as tall as 6 foot.
So this is the magic patch.
These patches contain high doses of estrogen, bringing on early puberty in both boys and girls.
Sorry, darling, is that a bit uncomfortable?
It also rushes them through puberty, so bones finish growing much sooner than they would naturally.
So that's the patch, and you just pull off the sticky bits.
That's it. That's all you have to do.
Yep, there you go. All done.
Disability advocates are suspicious of parents seeking out the treatment. Kelly Vincent thinks they have an inherent conflict of interest and consent should only be granted after an independent review.
It is the right of children, whether or not they are disabled, to grow up to their potential physically, emotionally and mentally.
Just this month, Kelly put forward a motion in the upper house of the South Australian Parliament condemning growth attenuation therapy.
I do commend her for bringing this before our chamber, for exposing this issue.
But let us be clear, you do not lose your rights because you have a disability.
I put the question that the motion be agreed to. All those in favour?
Aye.
Against? Declare it carried.
It was passed unanimously.
If the person with disability can't give clear consent, then the parent or caregiver actually shouldn't be involved in giving that consent either, because ultimately the procedure is about making their care duties it more easy for them on a day-to-day basis.
What about when you hear people say that this treatment's all about making life more convenient for the parents?
I say that if my life is easier, his life is easier. It's a quality of life thing for both of us. It's not a convenience thing for me. That may be a byproduct of it, but that's not the...
It's not what's driving you.
No, it's not at all. If I'm coping, if I'm not breaking my back, if I don't fall over trying to lift an adult, then life is going to be better for him, isn't it? Khan is so severely disabled.
You're okay, honey.
You know, all his dignity and rights have been taken away from him. And that wasn't my doing. And I'm trying so hard to atone for that by doing all I can to make his life as good as it can be.
And Susie's not the only one who feels this way. Rob and Janine certainly have no regrets. They're convinced that Daryl-Ann has more to look forward to than she would have if she'd kept growing.
I'm a little cuckoo-clock, tick-tock, tick-tock, now I'm striking 4 o'clock.
1, 2, 3, 4.
Swimming is awesome for just relaxing, you know. She's always in some sort of equipment. She's always got gravity forcing her down. In the pool, she gets to be completely weightless and just relax. Some people argue that, oh well, you know, the kids get bigger, you have more carers, you have more equipment, and you can still do it. Well, actually, people just stop doing it. They just stop. Real life is that when these kids get bigger, their world gets smaller. And they don't get to do all of those things that a normal 10-year-old should be doing with their family. We know that without this treatment, Daryl was going to get bigger. And we knew that there would be more problems. Now we've got through all the hard stuff. Now we just get to enjoy being a family.